Simon & Schuster Audio presents 4 Hours of Fury, the untold story of World War II's largest airborne invasion and the final push into Nazi Germany, by James M. Fenelon, read by Arthur Morey. He conceived the two armies to be at each other panther fashion. He listened for a time. Then he began to run in the direction of the battle. He said, in substance to himself, that if the earth and the moon were about to clash, many persons would doubtless plan to get upon the roofs to witness the collision. Stephen Crane, The Red Badge of Courage. Prologue. On Saturday, March 24, 1945, an armada of over 2,000 Allied aircraft droned through the bright morning sky over Belgium. 17,000 airborne troops sat crammed in the cargo holds, waiting to be dropped via parachute and glider into Germany. Consisting of transport planes and more than 1,300 towed gliders, the line of aircraft stretched back to the horizon for hundreds of miles. Flying at an altitude of just 1,000 feet, the swarm generated a buzz that seemed to announce the fleet's arrival from every direction. Fighter escorts, biding their time and scanning for enemy aircraft, flew in lazy patterns above the staggered formations of lumbering transports. Spearheading what Allied commanders hoped would be the final offensive in Europe, the transports carried troops from two elite divisions, the British 6th and the American 17th Airborne. Both were to be dropped over the same patch of German farmland, 5 miles deep by 6 miles wide on the far banks of the Rhine River. As part of the largest operation since the Normandy invasion, the airborne units were to seize a bridgehead on the enemy side of the river and hold it until ground forces surged across the 400-yard width of the Rhine. While the Allies had conducted several airdrops during the war, this was the first into the enemy's homeland. They were invading, not liberating, and the stakes were high. Nazi propaganda broadcasts made it clear that the element of surprise had been lost. The enemy was waiting for them. In addition to the expected 55,000 dug-in Wehrmacht troops, would fanatical German civilians attack with hunting knives and pitchforks, or would they cower in their basements? No one knew. Sergeant John Chester and 384 other GIs of his battalion flew steadily on toward their drop zone in 42 C-47 transports. Chester, a confident 24-year-old section chief, occupied his time by writing a few postcards. Wanting to capture the novelty of his first combat jump, he scribbled the same note to both his mother and Kay, his gal back home in Missouri. "I am writing from a plane. We'll drop into Germany soon. Hope to be seeing you soon. I love you." Tucking away the postcards, Chester rested one hand on the buckle of his safety belt, remembering how he'd fought to stand up during his third training jump. Mortified by his body's unwillingness to rise to the occasion, panic had flooded through him before he realized he hadn't unfastened the buckle. That wouldn't happen today. Chester knew most of the men in the plane, having trained and fought with them since 1943. Some pretended to sleep while others smoked or just stared into space. No one spoke. The roar of the engines and the rattling of the airframe made conversation impossible, which was just fine. Most were dwelling on their own thoughts anyway. Chester briefly dwelled on the fact that this would be his 13th jump, but chased the creeping feelings of doubt and hesitation from his mind with his simple standard mantra. "You volunteered for this. You asked for it. Now go get the job done." The 2-hour flight from France had been uneventful, but that couldn't last. As the planes approached the Rhine, it was time to go to work. From the cockpit, the pilot flipped on the red caution light, informing the men in back that they were nearing Germany. As the aircraft began its descent, Chester unbuckled, stood, and yelled, "Get ready!" to the sitting jumpers. Those pretending to sleep snapped their eyes open and turned their attention aft, where Chester stood by the open cargo door, wind whipping at his uniform. The Rhine was the line of no return. Once they crossed it, they'd be over enemy territory. More than 10 minutes of flight time remained until they reached their drop zone, but given the possibility of getting shot down, they had to be ready to jump at any moment. This allowed the troopers to do what their pilots couldn't, bail out in the case of disaster. As artillerymen, Chester's plane load of paratroopers also had to drop their 75mm howitzer. The disassembled artillery piece was divided into a door bundle to be shoved out when the pilot flipped the jump light to green, and 6 bundles strapped to the underside of the aircraft, which would be released from inside the cabin. "Stand up! Hook up!" Chester bellowed over the sound of the deafening engines. He reinforced his verbal commands with hand and arm signals that the men knew. They in turn echoed the orders, yelling them back in a ritual that ensured everyone understood what was happening and was engaged in the process. It gave them something to focus on other than their fears. Overburdened with equipment, the troopers seated on each side of the plane struggled to get on their feet and form one line. Once standing, they attached their parachutes' static lines to the steel cable running the length of the cabin. Jumping at less than 500 feet, there wasn't time to deploy the chutes manually. The 13-foot static line took care of that, yanking the canopies open as the troopers fell away from the plane. The jumpers jerked down on their static lines, making sure the hooks locked shut. Satisfied everything was in order, they faced the rear of the plane and watched Chester and Manuel Pena shove the supply bundle to the edge of the open door. The bundle actually included multiple containers, made up of the howitzer's breech assembly, its wheels, and 10 artillery shells, lashed together into a single awkward mass that required 3 parachutes. The 2 men wrestled the bundle onto a number of dowel rods, which facilitated the bundle's quick exit and eased the hassle of forcing the 720-pound bulk over the metal surface of the plane's decking. At the Rhine, smoke and haze from the battle below obscured landmarks as the armada split up to head to their assigned drop zones. The ground forces had unleashed their attack before dawn and were still forcing their way across the Rhine under heavy fire. The pilots of Chester's unit, adhering to strict radio silence, watched helplessly as the 72 aircraft in front of them inadvertently veered off course. The C-47s carrying the artillerymen continued on the correct heading, but Chester, along with the rest of his battalion, was unaware that they would now be dropping first. Having been alerted to the oncoming planes, German anti-aircraft batteries filled the sky with 88mm and 20mm flak rounds, the shells arcing up at the descending transports and bursting into dark clouds of exploding shrapnel. Streams of tracer fire from heavy machine guns stabbed at the planes and added to the mayhem. The pilots felt like sitting ducks. To shake the aim of enemy gunners, they needed to alter their flight path and airspeed, but that wasn't an option. Being in formation and approaching the drop zone required a steady speed and course. They shifted in their seats and flew straight into the growing maelstrom, following orders while ignoring their instincts. Over the roar of the engines, the muffled detonations of flak could be heard from inside the plane. Behind the pilots, the troopers were buffeted about the shuddering cabin. Almost to a man, they'd erred in favor of carrying as much equipment as possible: machine guns, rifles, pistols, hand grenades, extra ammunition, explosives, knives, bayonets, and brass knuckles. In many cases, the parachute and equipment doubled the trooper's own weight. They supported themselves by holding on to one another, the airframe, or their static lines. Chester caught glimpses of the action outside and was alarmed by what he saw: multiple aircraft in flames and a sky bursting with flak. "Looks like we are going to be real short-handed," he thought. "Hope there are enough of us left to get the job done." As the men waited for the final command to jump, each struggled to stay on his feet as he pushed against the man in front, craning to get a glimpse of the jump light still read. They wanted out and crowded toward the open door. Whatever awaited them on the ground had to be better than waiting to get shot down. One trooper, with his eyes on Chester, placed his hand on the command switch to salvo the howitzer bundles secured snugly to the belly of their C-47. Kaboom! An explosion rocked the plane as a 20-millimeter shell burst through the floor, shredding Melvin Boatner's leg. He crumpled to the deck, clenching his teeth and grabbing at the wound. Al Perry and Nick Montanino rapidly unhooked his static line and slid him to the other side of the plane, out of the way. There was no time to administer first aid to the increasingly pale Boatner, and he couldn't be allowed to hamper the jumper's rush for the door. Realizing shrapnel had severed the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.